السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. إن شاء الله I will go within 20 minutes about what is the new of multiple myeloma in 2021. Multiple myeloma is still in 2021 non-curable disease, still a chronic disease. What about the diagnostic criteria? Diagnostic criteria we should now do urine protein electrophoresis with the serum protein. This is mandatory now, not allowed to do one of them. As you know, the clonal plasma cells all make the same monoclonal IgG protein and also produce the extra light chain that don't have a heavy chain pattern to which spine to causing free light chain. So this is very important issue to do the free light chains. And also you should know quantitative for the immunoglobulin, the monoclonal immunoglobulins. About the detection of plasma cells, it is from 50 years ago, but still now we have a problem with the bone marrow biopsy in Egypt to know what is the percentage actually for the plasma cells in our patient. Usually I see the complete blood pictures of my patient having an hemoglobin of 8 and with treatment hemoglobin reaching about 13 gram, which is very good. And I saw it is about 80% plasma cells in the bone marrow biopsy. So I neglect this. I'm so sorry. I tell you, I know most of my professors in clinical pathology now, but this is the situation in Egypt. The International Myeloma Working Group criteria for diagnosis adding three parts for when to treat multiple myeloma. The first one is 60% clonal bone marrow plasma cells and serum free light chain ratio more than 100 if involved kappa or less than 0.01 if the involved lambda. And the third part is the MRI study using 1% one focal lesions more than 5 mm in size. Why is this? Because these biomarkers can predict the risk of progression, very early progression, from if the plasma cells more than 60%, if the free light chains more than 100% milligram, or the MRI focal lesions more than 5 millimeters. The third part, what diagnostic criteria of imaging? Now, it is not allowed to do skeletal survey with MRI, but it is now low dose whole body CT, which is now available in my institution. National Cancer Institute have now low dose CT. And the second, you can do the best CT imaging because because the PET-CT can detect the bone lesion and also the plasma cytoma, and you can do the also the whole body MRI study. The fourth step, you should now do the cytogenetic, which is have a failure internationally. About 60% of the patient is positive for cytogenetic, but in Egypt still, I do a calculation for the last 2 years, about 30% now on my patient can go positive for the cytogenetic, which is a very good result, because 2 years ago, no cytogenetic done in myeloma. Now I go very rapid with when to treat smoldering myeloma. You know, all of us know there is no need for to treat the smoldering myeloma. But patients are asymptomatic. So the first symptoms may be catastrophic. We don't know who will get myeloma. We have better risk stratification system now. Treatment are toxic and they have انت الكمبيوتر هيقعد يعمل كده كتير. Treatment are toxic and have limited efficacy. We have highly effective therapy now. No evidence to suggest that the improved survival. So now the phase 3 trials is working. So this is the data about the risk scoring, the risk group for the smoldering myeloma, including the serum monoclonal antibody spikes more than 2 gram per deciliter, and free light chain ratio more than 20, and bone marrow plasma cells more than 20%, and classify the patient according to this to low risk, intermediate risk, and high risk. If the patient, there is no in the three points, is free, this is a low risk, intermediate risk, one score only, take score or high risk too. You show the difference between the progression for this patient. It's very rapid progression when the patient having a high risk. But another risk scoring including mineralized, the free light chain ratio taking from 0 to 5, M protein taking from 0 to 4 and the bone marrow plasma cell taking from 0 to 6. And according to this, you can also classify the patient, and you see also there is progression within 2 years for the high risk patient, or very high risk patient is very rapid for the patient when having score. So now we have a scoring system for a smoldering myeloma. So if your patient having a high risk scoring, you should start a treatment like a myeloma. Like, this is a trial, in a phase 2 trial, showing in lenalidomide with dexamethasone versus observation only. As you see, the with lenalidomide dexamethasone, the time to next treatment is about 9 years. This means the patient will have a 9 years free without treatment if you're starting the treatment with lenalidomide dexamethasone. So no advanced imaging. Many patients may have had active myeloma because it's all the patient not doing like a PET CT. Also, the overall survival from progression to the active disease, as you see from the lenalidomide with dexamethasone, the median overall survival is 6.4 years. And for the observation only is 4.7 years, which is highly significant. But the early treatment does not induce a more resistant relapses. So this is a very good issue, because when you're starting the treatment, you start, this is a chronic disease. So when my patient is relapsing, I will need another treatment. Will be resistant to the same treatment? No, the data shows that there is no resistance for in relapse area. Another trial is a phase 2 and phase 3 trial. So also lenalidomide single agent versus observation, and also so a highly significant for the lenalidomide versus observation. But we have more questions for this. If we treat, should we be treating like a myeloma, or should it be a low intensity to delay progression, or should it be more aggressive to potentially cure the disease, as this is a smoldering myeloma? If I having a more aggressive treatment, can I cure this patient? What is the good surrogate for curability? When do we stop treatment? Let us go for this. When adding daratumumab to enhance therapeutic effectiveness with lenalidomide in a smoldering myeloma, this is daratumumab with, as you know, this is an anti-CD38 monoclonal antibody, plus the lenalidomide and the dexamethasone, and versus lenalidomide, dexamethasone also. If the patient go for CR or PR, will continue therapy. If the patient progressing disease, will be off the study. This treatment, as you see, another study, which is called the curative strategy for a high-risk smoldering myeloma. This is an adding carfilzomib, lenalidomide, dexamethasone, followed by autologous stem cell transplant. I speak about smoldering myeloma, and go for consultation for the same regimen and follow-up maintenance for about 2 years, 24 months. As you see from the result, the overall response rate is very high, about 94%, and CR rate about 41%. What about the MRD negativity, which may be a curable disease, is about 30%. What's about the same study about the from the induction versus after high dose therapy, after consolidation, after maintenance? You see the CR is increasing with the induction is a 43, with the transplant 63 CR, consolidation 75, when you give maintenance 81. So this is a hope for the patient of smoldering myeloma to be cured. Also about the MRD, it is starting from the induction, it is about 33%, with after transplant 49%, after two cycle consultation 65%, after maintenance it is about 62%. Still, I said that MRD may be a hope of cure for the smoldering myeloma patient. The progression free survival is about 92%, and the overall survival is 96%. So what should we do today? Confirm smoldering myeloma diagnosis with advanced imaging to be sure. As I said before, you can treat myeloma if the MRI showing only 5 millimeters in the one lesion only. But if the patient is still a smoldering myeloma, multiple myeloma, high risk features, treat as a myeloma. High risk smoldering myeloma, clinical trial or lenalidomide dexa. Still until now, this is approved treatment for smoldering myeloma. A standard risk smoldering myeloma or low risk, follow up every 3 months. When evolving any phenotyping and progressive disease, go for treatment as small multiple myeloma. time. What about multiple myeloma? Multiple myeloma is active myeloma. You will be starting with what the patient is eligible for transplant or ineligible for transplant. Eligible for transplant, you will start with induction treatment, followed by autologous stem cell transplantation, maybe consolidation or not, maintenance and follow-up from there. When the patient is relapsed, it will be having short time for an extra treatment. When relapsing second time, it will have a less short time. When usually the patient receiving 4 lines of treatment until this refractory treatment. What about the transplant eligibility? The overall goal is to maximize the duration of a first response. So the trial starting about 10 years ago with lenalidomide dexamethasone versus VRD bortezomib lenalidomide dexa, and now about for this study, the standard line of treatment over worldwide in ESMO guidelines or American guidelines and CN guidelines, all of them for the VRD. Why? Because the overall response rate for the VRD is 82% versus only 72% for the RD arms. Another study comparing the VTD versus the VCD. Usually in Egypt, our protocol is the VCD, which is called the side party protocol, Velcade with the Indoxan and dexamethasone. But if you see that comparison between the VTD, including thalidomide, the very good partial response is about 66% versus 56%, which is significant. So, the VTD have a very good response versus VCD, but with a higher toxicity, especially the peripheral neuropathy. So still in Egypt, we can use VRD or Cyport, which is the VCD. Other studies showing when you're adding a 4-drug regimen for treatment of multiple myeloma, we're adding for the VRD, which I said before, this is a standard treatment for myeloma. We're adding the daratumumab as a monoclonal antibody. You see that the overall response rate is 94%. After the end of consultations, the overall response is 100%. During maintenance, the overall response rate is 100%. What about strange CR? Strange CR, this is a deep CR. This is by flow cytometry or by next generation sequencer, there is no plasma cells. And by immune fixation, there is no monoclonality. So as you see, about after the end of consultation, it is 25%. And during maintenance, it is about 63%. As I said again, this is my give a hope for treatment of myeloma to be a curable, potentially curable disease. Another study adding for the high risk patient, the carfilzomib, which is second generation pertuzumab, versus the carfilzomib with the induxan or carfilzomib with lenalidomide or another arm with KCD, KRD and KRD for a short time. You see from this trial, the analysis of the response is a very good response rate for the KRD, which is with a prolonged time, which is an 18 cycle versus only 12 cycles for KRD. But it is highly significant than the KCD. So lenalidomide with KRD, carfilzomib, having a very good response in a patient with newly diagnosed multiple myeloma patient, KRD followed by stem cell transplant, followed by 2-cycle KRD maintenance, and the 12 cycles of the KRD significantly improves the rate of pre-maintenance, the very good partial response, stringent CR, MRD negativity versus KCD, stem cell transplant, followed by the KCD. A pre-maintenance rate of more than very good partial response, stringent CR and the MRD negativity were similar between KRD followed by stem cell transplant, KRD maintenance and the 12 cycle of KRD. So now there is some data about you can allow the patient be without transplant for 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, but you should go for stem cell collection before starting therapy. You collect stem cell therapy and you can go for your high risk patient KRT for about 12 cycles and follow on the for maintenance with lenalidomide and follow up your patient. If your patient is relapsed, you can go for another line and go for autologous stem cell transplant late. But still until now, this is not approved. Still now, the early transplant is preferred than the late transplant. So Still transplantation is needed? Yes, when comparing the VRD, which is a standard treatment, 8 cycle versus VRD 3 cycle, autologous stem cell transplant followed by VRD 2 cycle, and in both arms, in lenalidomide maintenance, you show that the progression-free survival is about 50 months versus 63 months, but after 4 years, there is no difference in the overall survival because this is a very short duration. And another tri-stamina trial is a phase 2 trial comparing the patients less than 70 years when they go for transplant, followed by lenalidomide maintenance, or followed by consolidation with the same protocol, or followed by another second transplant, tandem transplant. The reason so that progression-free survival, there is no difference. Overall survival, there is no difference. But the data shows that the patient with a high-risk myeloma showing a very good response for the tandem transplant. What about the maintenance? Now, in 2021, still the lenalidomide maintenance is the standard of care for all patients with myeloma after treatment or after autologous stem cell transplant. It is having a 26% reduction in the risk of death, estimated 2.5 year increasing in a median overall survival. This is a very good data because this will increase not progression-free survival only, but also the overall survival. Another trial for pertuzumab maintenance, also the progression-free survival is less of morbidity and hazard of death and the progression by about 23%, but there is no difference in the overall survival. But now, pertuzumab is a standard of care as a maintenance treatment every two weeks for a high-risk patient or patient with renal affection which cannot be given lenalidomide maintenance. So, what about the patient ineligible for transplant? This is the first trial comparing the RD short time or 18 months versus RD continuous until disease progression versus the standard of care for older patients, which is the MPT. You see that the patient with continuous treatment having a 4 year progression free survival was about 32.6 versus 14.6. But the overall survival difference is short time. As I said again, this is a myeloma, which is a chronic disease. So the 4 years is a short time to be long for overall survival. VRD light decreasing the lenalidomide to a 15 milligram instead of 15 milligram, you see that progression-free survival is after 40 months is about 40%, and overall survival after the is about 60%. So, at the end of my talking, in 2022, the currently available treatment option for newly diagnosed patient was autologous stem cell transplant eligibility, induction triplet therapy is preferred regimen VRD. You can using for a high risk patient carfilzomib, lenalidomide, dexa, which is called KRD, or the VCD, which is a standard of care of many centers in Egypt. And now we're having a promising data, new data, with when adding the dartumobab as a anti-CD38 for the patient with the VRD. Autologous stem cell transplant should be consulted for all patients. There is no age limited. Now, 70 years? No, we can transplant the patient more than 70 years if in having a very good performance status. And there is no comorbidity index that prevent transplant. Maintenance, lenalidomide approved following stem cell transplant, and consider immunomodulatory drugs or pertuzumab maintenance for the high risk patient or the patient with renal affection. What about the patient with transplant ineligibility? Induction regimen, VRD, or what is called VRD light. It is the preferred type. Dartumumab with lenalidomide and dexamethasone is preferred in many centers now. Also, LKRD can be used. Lenalidomide, cyclophosphamide, dexa is a very good protocol because it's an oral treatment. If you don't need to, your patient to come every time from home and taking every week treatment, you can using this protocol, which is all of them oral treatment. Also, bortezomib, cyclophosphamide, dexamethasone, and also having a very good result about the dartumumab when you're adding with the VMB, or you can using only lenalidomide dexa, which is again is an oral treatment. Continuous therapy is short mandatory. When you're adding a patient with treatment, a patient with transplant eligibility, don't stop treatment. Continue treatment until this progression out or toxicity. This is my last slide. Thank you for your attention.